We're here with Marcel Granier of Radio Caracas. Marcel, you've had a long and illustrious career in media with Radio Caracas. I wonder if you would be willing to talk about your initial idea behind creating the channel and a bit about its evolution over time.
Well, the channel was already existing when I joined it. It's been on the air since 1953. I joined in 1969. Our idea was to reach as many Venezuelans as possible, to care for their interests, to entertain them, to inform them, and I think we were very successful at that.
I also know that have not always been well received in Venezuela. Could you talk a little bit about the first and second times that the channel was shut down?
Well, the relationship between media and government is always difficult because one of the roles of media is to be a watchdog for democracy, for transparency, for cleanliness, for responsibility. And some people in government don't like that. They don't like transparency. They don't like to explain what they are doing, the reasons. They don't like to explore, study the results of what they have done or how they have spent the money. So it's always been difficult. Sometimes you have to cover awful crimes that the government doesn't want to be reported or known. Our first experience with the shutdown was in 1976, when the general manager of an American company was kidnapped by the leftist guerrilla. And we covered those news. The government didn't want it to be covered, so they went for the easy way, shut down, closed the messenger, and the poor guy was, the kidnapping was at that time the longest in history. He was 4 years. That changed completely his life, his family life, his business life, his attitude towards life. It was a terrible event, really. That was one. The other one was because of a mistake of a night operator. He was at 1 a.m. He was watching what he shouldn't be watching, and he switched the wrong cable, and on the air went a movie that should not have been on the air. And then came Chavez, but that was a completely different story. From the very beginning, it was clear that Chavez didn't like free media, that he feared it, that he disliked what we were covering. I've been studying all the material we broadcast in the 5 years previous to our shutdown by Chavez. And you see all the reporting about the military high brass involved in drug trafficking, all the funds that had disappeared. Chavez was able to mismanage $2 trillion, which is a fairly big amount. He didn't like to talk about that. He never explained how he was spending the money, where he was investing.
How did you manage those situations? How did you keep Radio Caracas alive during those periods?
Well, the first one was only for 24 hours, so that was very easy. Actually, I think our ratings went up after the shutdown. And the same thing with the second. Actually, the second one was because, now I remember, was because we had three shutdowns. The second one was because we reported on a youth hostel run by the government where the kids were being chained to their beds, and it was a very messy, awful place. And the government didn't want the people to know what they were doing with the kids, for obvious reasons. In both those cases, the end result was the ratings were higher and the popularity of the station was higher because people realized that what we had done was in the interest of the public. With Chavez, as I tell you, it was different. No, when he announced that he had decided to close down RCTV, Radio Caracas, he did it in military uniform, a campaign uniform, fatigues, and in front of the high command of the military forces. So it was obvious a price he was giving to them. So there would be no more reporting about their involvement in in drug trafficking or in arms trafficking or people trafficking or crimes against human dignity or against the life of people. So they were very satisfied with that. And the public resented it very much. After our closing down, the students came to the streets, and that hadn't happened for 50 years. So we had, in the 20th century, Venezuela had three occasions when the students went to the street. In 1928, during the dictatorship of General Juan Vicente Gómez. In 1957, during the dictatorship of Marcos Pérez Jiménez. And in 2007, against the dictatorship of Hugo Chavez. And that movement has remained and been very active. I think that's the people who will assume the ruling of the country eventually.
Now, it's clear that media for you is, it's not just about the media, that it has this bigger social role. And I was wondering if you would share a bit about how did you arrive at some of these values? Is it in your early career? Is it something that came over time?
Family, I would say, was the first. You have to stand for your values. You have to fight for them. You have a responsibility when running, such an important institution as the media, particularly in the case of Radio Caracas, which was the largest and longest running TV station in Venezuela. And then when you are on the job, you understand why entertainers or journalists are doing what they are doing. And you have a commitment to the public. At one moment, the government proposed to buy the station. And we thought, what are we going to do? Are we going to give them the name of Radio Caracas and all that it means so that they can lie to people, they can manipulate information the way they do in public media? And we decided, no, we cannot do that. Running a media is of course, is a difficult job because you have a responsibility with your shareholders you are running a business, a for-profit organization, but you also have an even bigger responsibility with your community, with the people who watch you, who trust in you, who believe what you say. So it's you have to arbitrate between all those interests.
You've discussed a bit about the past of Radio Caracas, and I'm wondering if you would also talk a bit about what you see as its future in Venezuela.
Well, we won. We took our case to the Venezuelan courts. They have not paid any attention to our claims. So in view of that, and according to some international treaties that Venezuela has signed, we went to the Inter-American System on Human Rights. We won the case at the Commission on Human Rights, so we went to the court. And the court decided in our favor. So now we have a clear title to recover all our equipment and our frequencies and our permits. Therefore, I'm preparing for that. The government has decided that they will not comply with the ruling, in spite of the fact that they participated in the trial. They had the same opportunity we had. They sent their lawyers, much more lawyers than we had. They sent their witnesses, their experts. They spent a big, big effort fighting the case, and they lost it. Now that they have lost it, they decided that they won't comply with the ruling. But eventually, the Venezuelan state will have to comply with that decision because the treaty we have signed and because Article 31 of the Constitution says so. So I'm preparing for that. I'm beginning to realize that the new world is going to be completely different. Audiences have changed, the way people receive their entertainment or their news and select it is totally different to what it was 10 years ago. The advertisers have different strategies than what they had at that time. At that time, when we're shut down, we covered 98% of the country and its population, and we had about half of the audience. And So for advertisers, it was very useful to go to Radio Caracas because they knew that in 15 days, with just one ad, they would reach the whole population of the country. And now it's going to be quite different. Equipment, technology is hugely different. I mean, cameras are totally different. We can see here the cameras. You have a totally different camera to what I was used to in television. So the new technology, the internet has made big changes. You have so many different things and ways and so many options. I mean, for the most of my life in television, in Venezuela, there were two options for the people. It was either us or our competitors, and that was it. Now we have millions of competitors. So it's we have to rethink our ways, and it's going to be a big challenge. I'm very happy to have this challenge. It's the fifth challenge I've had in the last 10 days, and all of those I have enjoyed very much. We digitalized the company. We went into internet before anybody else in Venezuela. We were the first to digitalize. We had to open a cable and internet and satellite operation. Then we went to the internet again, not as provider, but as suppliers. So it's going to be a big challenge, and I'm happy to be able to stand to it.
Thank you very much, Marcel.
Thank you.